You're watching City Channel 4, your window to our community.
So I've been wanting to really understand the history of our retail space here for a long time. And it's been difficult. When you're running a business, there's just so much to do, and I didn't have time to do the research myself. So I went to the University of Iowa's history department and was trying to find an intern. And got one, and he started the work. He couldn't complete the work. And then I met Al. And Al Dawson was enthusiastically willing to help us out. So he is our official historian and genealogist for Beadology Iowa. So welcome, my name is Karen Covey. I am co-owner of Beadology with my sister Laurel Covey. We're both UI alums. Although we don't have great memories of Barbara's Bake Shop because my mom was such a great baker, she would not pay to get baked goods. So we're really glad to have you. A few housekeeping things. There are drinks and some desserts at the table. If you need a gluten-free sweet, they are there. There is a restroom outside of the large French doors to your right. We're very happy to have this event co-sponsored by the center, the senior center, the Johnson County, Iowa City Senior Center, and they've provided some of the equipment for us. And this is being taped by Channel 4. And so you can go online to find out when it will be broadcast. So you can get a repeat of this or tell other people about it who have missed it. Al's been real invaluable to us, and I look forward to this afternoon. There's a little secret that is going to be revealed that he asked if he could reveal it to me, and I said, no, please do not, because I want it unveiled to me too, with my community members, in the context of the whole story. And Al is a storyteller, so I'm looking forward to this. Al holds an MA in Victorian History from the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill, and is a member of the Baker Street Irregulars, the Younger Stanfords of Iowa City, and the Bookmakers of Toronto. He's done all kinds of things in his life. He's worked at a hotel, he's worked at conference centers, he was a night manager at the student union. How many people here worked at the student union at some time in their career here? Few of us. I worked a grill. He worked for the Cleveland Indians. And when he was in Iowa City, he worked for the Iowa City Press Citizen and Midwest One Bank. So Al's a historical and genealogical consultant, and he's working on a book called The Trousered Princess, Hope Glenn of Iowa City, Chicago, and London. And he'll have two papers published very soon. He serves as a secretary for Old Capitol Toastmasters and has served on the board of the Iowa Genealogical Society. Last fall, he taught a course at the Senior Center on Lewis Carroll. And in his spare time, he is dominated by three Siberian Huskies. Al's wife is Deborah Dawson, an endowed professor at the University College of Dentistry, and their son is also a biostatistician teaching at Texas Tech. Deborah is a really good seed bead weaver and a very creative soul. Al's lucky to hang out with her, and he with her. So, Al Dawson.
Good afternoon, and thank you, Karen, for that introduction and for being our host today. Thank you also to Michelle Bowman and the AV staff of the Johnson County Senior Center for your support of the program, and thank you all for attending today. Now, I'm going to sound a little like Opie today because I have a cold. I'm sorry. If I get to Aunt B, then you know we're in trouble. But a few words on the purpose of the presentation. Yes, I do wish to share with you many of the things I've learned about this building and the block. Today, when you leave, you'll be enlightened about the three letters above our head. You'll be enlightened on a couple other things too. But my primary goal is for you to have fun, because otherwise you're going to miss the whole purpose of what Beadology is all about. You've been in this store before. You've been out in this section. You've seen the beautiful things that Karen has to offer. You've wandered around making your selections, and you peeked back in this room, and you see people hard at work But you were wrong. They were hard at fun, because that's what beadology is all about. And I speak with secondhand knowledge because my wife is here many, many hours of the week, and she is back here creating beautiful items of art. Not works of art, funds of art. So that's what this presentation should reflect the building we're in. I ask one thing of you, please hold all questions and comments, except oohs and ahs, of course, until the very end. We have 134 years in time and less than 45 minutes to present it. I'll make mistakes, but correct me later. If we do it at the end, we can take that off the tape. I was born in Michigan. So I have only been in Iowa City for a decade and a half, so I can't be called a local historian. We have some people here that can be called that. Bob Hibbs, my good friend, here in the front. Tom Schuline is here today, who is working on becoming a great local historian. He's done many fine presentations at the center. Tim Parent, I don't think, is here today, but he would be a third that I would say is a local historian. Think of me as a talented amateur, all right? And being a talented amateur and not being from Iowa, I can't be entrusted with the secret of the terrible thing. The terrible thing, whatever it was, happened sometime between 1879 and 1890. For over a century, some people in this community, I won't identify them, have been working very hard to erase our knowledge of the 1880s. Just before the gay 90s, we had the energetic 80s here in Iowa City. I don't think that the terrible thing, whatever it was, is related to the mysteries of the IXL Center, but I can definitely tell you that it's one of the reasons that you're going to learn some of those mysteries and their answers today for the first time, because it stood in the way of anyone finding that. And of course, the biggest mystery is, what does IXL stand for? Less than a year ago, after admiring those letters from across the street, in front of the Englert, I walked over here to meet with Karen. We talked about some of the things she talked about in her introduction, what she wanted to have done, what had already been done, and part of the deal was I would give a talk, and then later we would do a booklet, as similar to what I did for Ewers Menswear for their 100th anniversary. In my innocence, I thought this project would take 2-3 months tops. But I still cautioned Karen that my work on a book and travel I had planned might interfere. So we set very flexible deadlines on that. And then I went to work. Now, because I don't like to read from my slides, I'm going to let you read. This is kind of a blanket acknowledgement. So I didn't know how it would show up on this screen. Didn't have to write everything on every slide. And you see some of the websites that I spend my money on. And then I spend a lot of time looking at newspapers, and I probably should have added the St. Louis papers on here too. And two books that I used as reference books. I didn't take any photos from them, but I used as reference books, and you should own both of these books, but buy them locally. Don't go through Amazon, buy them locally. All right, anyone who knows anything about historical research or genealogical research in this town knows the place you have to start is the State Historical Society Library and Research Center at the corner of Gilbert and Iowa. Mary Bennett and her fine staff, including Charles Allison and my friend Randall, who is here today, another member of the Bootmakers of Toronto, as well as the local group, they have all assisted me in my research projects, but they are not responsible for nor necessarily endorse my results. They're having an open house this weekend on Saturday, celebrating 160 years, and it will be from 1 to 4, is that right? There'll be music and food, and I'll be there, but not speaking. Probably by that point, my voice will be completely dead anyway. And my good friend, Joni Hinman, is putting together a display of the World War II project that she's been working on with countless others from our Genie Society. Earlier that same day, the Genealogical Society will be meeting in its regular meeting place out on Bradford at the LDS Church. And we have a German genealogist, Uta Brandenburg, who will be speaking to us that day. Thus endeth the advertising portion of my speech. Now, I'm going to admit to a fetish here. This and its brothers and sisters, after the Bible and the art of the deal, and since we're here at Beadology, let's also say the ecclesiastical history by the Venerable Bead, is my favorite book. I love city directories. I will use them online. I will use them on microfilm. But I love the actual books. I love the feel of them, the smell of them. The older, the better. But it's the content. It's the content that makes them my go-to reference for a project like this, especially a project connected with buildings. In fact, they are indispensable. Now, I'm not sure how long I was out on the floor of the library after Mary Bennett told me there were no Iowa City directories for the entire decade of the 1880s. My blood pressure revived somewhat when she told me there were statewide directories for 1882 and 1884, and they contained information on Iowa City. And in fact, they had very definite information I could use. So that was a big disappointment. That gave at least two or three more months on the project. And then there are newspapers. But even newspapers, libraries are tending to throw those out, the microfilm, because, oh, they're on newspapers.com. Well, the gaps are sometimes there. But there are good newspapers at the Iowa City Public Library and at the State Historical Library that are on microfilm. They're not indexed, so you have to kind of hunt for things. Well, what about tax records? This is a building. They paid taxes. There must be tax records. So I got in touch with Mr. Kritz. He wrote me back and told me that for this decade, there were tax records. They were moved to a storage facility, and 4 years ago, they all burned up. And what about the LDS? They come around, and they photograph things. What about, did they photograph the tax records? They did for the 1870s, but again, not for the 1880s. So you can see why I suddenly developed this theory of the terrible thing, not knowing what it is we're trying to cover up, but it certainly didn't help me on my project here. Other resources, of course, were the recorder's office, Kim Painter, wonderful lady, and her staff, and the auditor's office down below, who once in a while will open that secret door for you if you look very nice and wear a suit over there. I would have bowed out gracefully, and Karen doesn't know this. I considered bowing out of the project, but two things kept me going. One was I was bound and determined to find the mysteries of the IXL Center. And there was this persistent smell of baked bread, which Karen has already spoken about. You'll see that for at least half of this building, this part, it was for 80-some years, a bakery of some sort or another. There was a bakery before Barbara. My paternal grandfather, Seymour Dawson, owned and operated two bakeries in Detroit and in Lowell, Michigan. And so we Dawsons, we have gluten in our blood. We're not quitters either. Our voice may give out, but we're not quitters. Now, a few facts you must understand on how the IXL block came to be named. One of Al's rules is questions are more important than answers. If you think you know the answer and you go looking for the answer, you're not going to find anything. This works in my wife's field, too, and Trudy knows this as well. People come to my wife and give data to her and say, this is what I've found. And she goes, no, we have to look at the data first. So my first question was, who? Who was the first occupant of 220? And I put a chart over on the wall, and I'll be referring to that as kind of a help to, and there'll be a slide of it. But this building went through a couple of transformations. So when I say 220 at the start, it's the entire building as you see it today. But when we're talking about like Barbara's, it's this half of the building. But as you can see, the building does extend much further back than the rest of the block, and that was useful for all its purposes. Now, part of the problem for finding 220 in the 1880s is 220 was on the other side of the street. This may have something to do with a terrible thing, I'm not sure. But for over a decade, people on this side of the street lived at odd-numbered buildings, and it was even-numbered over there. And the proof of that is an ad, and another ad with the wrong number on it, because it wouldn't be in 223. And you can see very little numbers at the bottom. Those are odd numbers at the bottom. This is a Sanford insurance map, fire insurance map. Ironically, one of them came out in February 1926, the same month that we had a fire across the street at the Engler. And they're wonderful if you can get them in book form. But even with Randall's help, I've only had one that came into my access. And once it was found out by the upper echelons, they never let me do that again. But they are all on microfiche, and they're good to use. So the first person, and we're just going to talk about even numbers here. I just want to let you know that there were odd numbers for a while. The first person that was in this building is Robert Livingston Dunlap. And Robert's name is more often seen as R.L. Dunlap. And that helped because he had a son named Ralph, whose middle initial was L. And so it passed from father to son, and there were two generations. And that often confused people like Irving Weber. He'd attribute things to one that was actually the other. And you can see he looks like one of the Smith brothers. But he's a wonderful person. And when we do the booklet, and when I do a book several years down the line, you're going to learn a lot more than I can tell you today about Robert Livingston Dunlap. But think of him as the founding father of the IXL block. Now, he sold agricultural implements. This was his showroom. His actual warehouse was down the street on the left side. It's where the School of Engineering is today. He had a big warehouse, and in some way it was called the Striped Warehouse. I've never seen a photograph of it, but it apparently looked like a circus tent, I think. Now we'll return to Robert later, R.L. Dunlap. And the next person you need to know was on this side of the wall originally in 1883. And that is Harry C. Smith. And there are two Harry C. Smiths, too. His son, who was a merchant, he had the grocery store on Summit Street, which is now a bakery. Harry was a man of many hats. He was a carpenter, a builder, and you'll see he had a lot to do with this building. So we'll come back to these two men. I was lucky to get this photograph. I got in touch with one of his descendants. Being a genealogist, I have sneaky ways of finding people. And he sent me this picture. It's inside a locket. It's believed that that was owned by Mrs. Smith. So therefore, we hope it's Harry and not somebody else that Mrs. Smith had a question. Okay. Now, the next question I asked was what? And the natural question here, after you go to the State Historical Society and end up on the floor, is what did Irving Weber say about this building? And he wrote about it in his books that were collections of his columns, and he wrote about it in his columns, and he said many things. The one thing that he said that I was able to verify for sure was there was a roller rink in this building. Now, Irving said it was on the third floor, and since we know there were schools on the third floor, that seems like that would be kind of disruptive. It was actually right above us on the second floor, which later became apartments. The other things that Irving said, one was that the IXL, the letters IXL, are a mystery, okay? And then he tried to explain the mystery, and he said that the IXL was a grocery store. The problem with that is you're mixing 19th century apples with 20th century oranges. But to give him credit, Irving Weber, then in our parlance today, walked that back. He said he never had met anyone who could tell him where the grocery store was or what years it was there. And there was a grocery store in this building for many years. It was, again, on this side, the part that's missing. It was called the Economy Cash Grocery Store, and it was during the Great Depression. It was there for about a dozen years. So, I went back to the library. Oh, a little more about the roller rink. Big craze. I have lots of articles on file about roller skating all around America. We invented this here. This is not Russia. This is not China. We invented roller skating here. And I found verification that the IXL roller skating rink, Dunlap and Smith proprietors, H.C. Smith manager, was here. And that seems to be here through the end of the 1880s, a little bit into the 1890s. They also advertised in the newspaper and told you things. It was a very high class roller rink. Nothing risque went on in this roller rink because both Dunlap and Smith were very religious men. Okay, so what about other people who have looked into the IXL Center besides the graduate student and myself? The Downtown Commission looked into it, and this is kind of architectural information. Whenever you don't know what style of building is in Iowa City, use Italianate because it's pretty much going to be the case. And this is interesting because it tells you that about the building next door, which I won't talk a lot about, 218. But it still retains some of the original work in it. But here's, to me, the most interesting thing they came up with for two reasons. One is they tell you how the land became available, and that's only part of it. As I looked into it, part of the land on this street was church land. It was, and also behind us, because we're in block 66. Block 66 is the entire block. It contains Iowa Avenue right here. Now, across the street, that's not block 66, but if you don't have to cross the street and you go around the corner, you're in block 66, and it always has been and always will be. So part of the land had to be special acts of the legislature to build things on it because it was reserved for church. Remember, there is a church street here, and the idea was we were going to have a lot more churches in Iowa City. Well, that didn't happen, and we have a lot. And so in order to get that land free, they had to go through some bells and whistles. So there was partly the sheriff's sale and partly the church lands that were used. But to me, the most important thing in here is source of its name unknown. So 16 years ago, we're still bringing experts in from Des Moines. They're looking at it, and they can't figure out what's it all about. You lucky people, however, are going to find out right now. Theory one. Okay, and theory one comes from this book. I hope you know that for the first 100 years or so, the University of Iowa was called the State University of Iowa, SUI, and that's how you'll see it. That's why I'm wearing red today, because we're at State. And this is a wonderful, there are not many photographs that I've been able to find of this building early on, but this is a sketch from 1896. It's an advertisement inside the quill. And this is brought to you by the number three, because there are two things, I should have had three things, but you know, I had to cut back because of time. There are two things with the number three that makes this sketch important. The first is the threesome that you see in this. On the left, that shorter building that says Paints and Oils, is the Stillwell building. That building today matches the other two buildings that are still here, because the far building was torn down in 1961. I don't know when that addition was made, but it gives the threesome still. The other thing about this is there are three complete schools. Now, you hear about the Iowa City Commercial College, and you hear about the Iowa City Academy, but note down here in the corner, it's not a very good slide, it says the Iowa City School of Shorthand. So this leads me to the Romantic Theory. And I like the Romantic Theory. I was just going to go with the Romantic Theory until I got lucky. It's the School of Shorthand. We're in the City of Literature. It's the School of Shorthand. So why shouldn't IXL mean I excel? I'm up here in the schools, these wonderful schools, IXL. And the School of Shorthand would be, you know, one of the promoters of that. We'll see if that's true. These two theories that I'm going to present to you today, I think, are interlocked, so they can both be true. You don't have to deal with any alternative facts today, okay? My only Trump joke. Okay, here's your overview. 220 is this current space, up to the front and in the back. And then in 1911, your key date, it becomes two stores. And it stays that way until around 2000, after Barbara's closes in 1998. It took a while to get what they wanted to get done. And we're not going to cover everything that's been in this building, but this is kind of an overview for a couple years. You can see how many opticians and jewelers there have been in this building. Isn't it wonderful? We have the discerning eye next door and this wonderful store here. So we're still in the tradition of what this building has been. Now, in 1911, there were two sales. One was from Huldah, the widow of Robert Livingston Dunlap, and she sold the building to her son. And then her son sold the building to J.J. Ostiek and T.A. Tennyson. These are two interesting men. They owned City Bakery. They had purchased that in 1908 and ran that at a different location. And then they bought it, this building. And they were the ones that did the remodeling, and they rented out the space, and they kept the space for themselves. Now, checking my time here. I'm always amused when I look things up. I don't have any pictures of these gentlemen to show you, but from their descriptions on their World War II draft registration cards and earlier documents, it seems like these two men were almost twins. They were like half an inch apart. Well, they were actually uncle and nephew. Thomas was the uncle. But they were uncle and nephew who were less than 2 years apart in age. And being a genealogist, I had to check that out. So I went and I found their family tree, and yes, John Joseph's grandmother was the mother of her youngest son, Thomas Andrew Tennyson. So they were indeed genetically alike. But the thing that tickled me the most was they had complexion on both of them were pale. Well, yeah, they worked back here with dough all the time and probably went next to City Hall to make that registration. I think that was why they were pale, but they looked very much alike, apparently. Okay, let me then briefly continue with an outline of what this building has been before we get into the mysteries. It was a mystery to me, and I have to admit I was stupid. I looked at it in my Excel spreadsheet, and it didn't hit me until I put it on a slide. That's the after slide. From 1918 to 1919, this is the bakery, remember? Over here on this side in 220, there was a mortuary connected with the Donahues. Why those 2 years? I'm not qualified to be a local historian. I'm not even qualified to be a real historian until it came up on my screen and I said, oh yeah, Spanish influenza. Not only did many buildings in this town become temporary hospitals, this became a mortuary add-on. And you probably know that the Yacht Club was a mortuary for many years. So once the epidemic was over, this is from December of 1919, then it was available for other things, and the Methodist ladies had their church fair here. Now, City Bakery remained in 222, this space, until Barbara's Bake Shop took over in 1953. And it closed in 1998. So overall, we had about 87 years of gluten on this side of the building. By the way, there was no Barbara, at least not in Iowa City. Barbara was a name they took from a successful bake shop in Des Moines. And there was another Barbara's down on the Ped Mall, what's now the Ped Mall. So in the 1920s, Carl Stock of a prominent local family. He had an electrical shop here, and you see some of the things that he actually sold. Am I got the right slide here? Let's see. No, it's not covering that. Anyway, there's more to it up above. Somehow that got. Okay. Anyway, he was here. He would have been in an excellent position to see that fire across the street at the Englert. I imagine he went across to help, because of course, what happens if it jumps the street? But it didn't. It stayed in that block and didn't come into block 66. Now, Isaac Fuchs, known as I, as he was an optometrist as well as a jeweler, and you see him with the jeweler's thing in his eye there. I've talked to several people, including Bob Hibbs, who were customers, and people in their family have beautiful pieces of jewelry that he sold. He was in this building from 1934 to 1973. He'd actually been in other locations. He was in the Garden Theater building, which Englert also owned, down the street for several years. And he had been an apprentice with somebody else. So he had been in the business for really over 60 years when he died. And after he died, his daughter and her husband ran the store for another 8 or 10 years, I guess. So he is one of the veterans of this building. Next door, again, on this side, where there's no longer a building, was the Rainbow Cafe. And I know it's a disappointment to Karen that I didn't find a lot about the Rainbow Cafe, but it was only in existence. It was quite a good place because people talk about it, but it was only in existence for 6 years. It started in 1955, and then they tore down the building along with City Hall. But it was a great place for people from City Hall to come and have, you know, political discussions and things like that. So Karen was disappointed with two things. First of all, it wasn't in this building, and secondly, that it had so short a time over there. Now, from 1974 until the renovation, a period of about 25 years, 220, we're talking about that part of the building over there. Make sure I got myself right. Let me look at my own chart here. Yeah, I'm in 222. 220 was a series of hair salons. And some of you may remember these. One was the Gemini Beauty Salon, which was run by two gentlemen. For 1 year, there was something called Idol Makers, which sounds like a great name. And Chris Hair Care was also here for several years too. Now, if you look in the 2004 city directory and the ones in front of it for a couple years, there's something kind of amazing. Like Brigadoon, this building is not here. It has disappeared. Well, that's during the renovation, so there was nothing to put in. They do have information about the people who lived in the apartments above, but not about this building, because this building was being renovated. And this is probably the fourth mystery of the IXL block. There was something in here called the Cage Techno Bar. And if you know a lot about that, I'd love to have you come talk to me, because I have friends in the newspaper business, and I've asked them about it. They won't talk about it. I've talked to people I know, and they just won't talk about it. I do know from the one newspaper clipping I found that I think it was a non-alcoholic facility, but it's a mystery, and so I'm not going to talk about it, except that it did bring about the re-renovation of this building. So again, 220 is this entire space. In 2008, Dawn's Hide and Beadaway moved in, and in 2011, the shop became Beadology under the control of our host and her sister. Now, before I get back to the mysteries, we must honor one person, and that person is Persis. This is the only photograph I could find of her from a Mason City paper. Persis Sheldon. Okay, now, she is going to represent the hundreds of people who have lived on the second floor of this building. She is our representative today. I want to make it perfectly clear, the fact that she is my distant cousin, sharing several New England ancestors, was not a factor in my selection of her as our representative. She lived here for, I think, almost 40 years. Think of her as the Scarlet Pimpernel of the IXL block. By day, an administrative assistant at Oakdale Sanatorium, but by night, a leader in the ladies' militant, the business and professional women, the DAR, and the Mayflower Society. She held statewide positions in all of these, and she was very frequently in the Press Citizen's Our Town column. They would talk about her when she had a sinus infection and had to go in for surgery. They would talk about her when she broke an arm. But they would talk about good things as well. People obviously loved this woman because she is often in the society pages. I'm going to leave her up while I talk about this because I don't want to give away the ghost here. I was on my way to a fire when I discovered the key to the solution of the IXL mysteries. It was the Great Fire of Chicago. So I was in the Iowa City Republican on microfilm at the State Historical Society Library and Research Center, and I was trying to find out whether Hope Glenn, the heroine of my book, was going to be in Chicago where she was training, or in Iowa City when the fire broke out in October of that year. I thought it would be mentioned, several people were mentioned. I never got to the fire that day, at least. Because the thing about microfilm is, you have to crank it, you know? You have to make it move forward. And then you have to stop and see where you are. And you have to crank it some more. And while I was cranking it, I found this. Look in the upper left-hand corner. Now that does not refer to this below. That kind of devil's tool down there is a plow. But it talks about the IXL cultivator, okay? An agricultural implement with the letters IXL. Now I'm in the wrong decade. I'm in the wrong project. You know, this is dumb luck on my part, not hard work. It just fell in my lap. Now I was working on another project. But who put this ad in the paper? Well, it was a column every week in the paper, and it was Dunlap's column, our old friend Robert Livingston Dunlap, every week. And he had lots of funny things in his column besides the things that he put in. So now I knew it was a trademark. So the rest was easy. You know, all I had to do was go to England and find out about the IXL cutlery company. Now here's the deal. Charles Dickens could tell you this. Mark Twain could tell you this. In the 19th century, people paid kind of fast and loose on either side of the Atlantic with your intellectual property or your real property. If Dickens published a book in London, he wanted to publish one that he was going to get the credit for in New York. The same with Twain, because there were people that would steal your information. And after all, this was England. They owed us. As Tom Schuline can tell you, we invented Brexit. You know, we got the hell out. And so we didn't owe them anything. But sooner or later, this was going to catch up with people. The IXL cultivators that Dunlap sold, showed off in this building, sold out of the warehouse downtown, further downtown, may have come from Babcock and Stilson in Galesburg. He makes a reference in also known as the Galesburg cultivator. It implies that, but it doesn't actually say that's where he bought them. And there you see one of their ads. They sold more than one thing called IXL. But they didn't actually own any legal rights to that. The first man that patented anything in the United States for IXL was in California. He had developed a new kind of metal that he was trying to sell to the US government for railroads and to the big railroad companies because it had less friction and so it would make things go faster. And then I found out he moved to St. Louis, Missouri. There he is in a St. Louis city directory. The IXL metal company, his name is George Hunt. And if you can decipher the address there, he's down on what's known as Laclede's Landing. Have you been there? It's a tourist location now. But in those days, it was the place where people got off the riverboat, loaded up with stuff, and moved west. Just like people came to Iowa City, we were the westernmost terminus of the train in 1856, and that didn't change for the next 10 years because of the Civil War. People came to Iowa City on the railroad. They might build some hand carts and they might trek, or they might find other wagons and get off. But they loaded up in both places on hardware. And St. Louis, Missouri was the hardware capital of the world, certainly in the United States, when it came to the late 19th century. So to find this man in St. Louis was somewhat interesting when I found out online about Otto Witte. Now this building still exists. I have eaten lunch at the Witte building. And it wasn't a hardware store, it was a hardware factory. They shipped on the river and they shipped on the railroad all around the country. And they had men that were known as the Knights of the Briefcase. And these were people that went around as salespeople, you know, kind of like right here in River City, but they were selling something that people could use. They were selling hardware. And it was my theory, because Robert Livingston Dunlap is in the papers not as often as Persis Sheldon, but he's in the papers a lot because of mysterious trips he's taken in little small towns in Iowa. I think he was one of the Knights. I can't absolutely prove that. But I wanted to find a connection between him and St. Louis. I found a connection in his obituary. It talks about his son Marcus, who is the eldest son, M.F., Marcus Fulton Dunlap. They all went by their initials. And it told me Marcus came up for the funeral from Missouri. So Karen Cubby immediately bought me a ticket so I could fly to St. Louis. And I spent about 7 days there working with city directories. I was in heaven. They actually have them on shelves. They're in little boxes. You have to take ribbons off and get in there. And you have to be careful not to, you know, destroy too much of it while you're living. Now, I was in heaven for about 2 or 3 days. But when you're going through 50 years of city directory, because it was not the only project I was working on, it gets a little tiresome. You're inhaling all that stuff. And so, I'm sorry, I'm not going to run over too much. I was going to give up. I gave up. I got to the 50-year point. We're at 1900. That's it. That's as far as I'm going. I was looking for Marcus. I didn't find him. And then I said to myself, Al, you are such a wuss. And I went over and I picked up the 51st city directory, which was 1901. And in that city directory, I found M.F. Dunlap. I knew he lived in St. Charles. I had done my research. I knew that he ran a flour mill in St. Charles. But in 1901, he is the vice president of a flour mill in Laclede's Landing, on the other side of the Eads Bridge. So here's my connection. My theory is, for both his brother and his father beforehand, he was their shipping agent. He got the stuff from Otto Witte, and he sent it up the river, or he put it on railroads. He was the local man. So he had two jobs, really. But I knew it was him because it gave his residence as St. Charles, Missouri. It wasn't another M.F. Dunlap. Sorry, no pun intended there. And I was just in heaven because I found the connection I was looking for. I then researched and found that in 1874, December, the year that he graduated from the SUI, he went down to St. Louis. He's in the newspapers. When you're in newspapers for the 19th century, look for the column of hotel arrivals. And we have them here in Iowa City in the papers. Hotel arrivals. Here's the people that came into the city. And you couldn't, unless you gave a fake name, you couldn't fool around in Iowa City. So he's a hotel arrival, December 1874, at the Everett House. Well, I know the Everett House is pretty top dollar because Mark Twain stayed there. And it's very close to Laclede's Landing and where Witte and his friends had their hardware stores. You can't get there on foot today because there's a big interstate highway that goes through there, but it was quite easy in 1874. So, what sent him to St. Louis or to St. Charles? A little sad thing here. When you're looking, what sent his father to Iowa City in 1858 was his wife died. He had a thriving business outside of Chicago. You've been there many times. It's got an Irish name now, it's called O'Hare. He was in that community, and I won't tell you until the book comes out all the wonderful things he did there, but he left there because his wife died. He and Marcus and Fanny of the first family came to Iowa City, and I think Marcus came from Iowa City to Missouri for two reasons. First, he had a famous father who was doing the same thing. He wanted to be his own man. but often look for a grave. Look for a wife, look for a child. This is the grave next to her grandparents of Alma Dunlap. She only lived a little more than one year, and she was the daughter of Marcus and his wife. And you're often going to find that if you have an unexplained move in your family, why did they move? That a death of a child or the death of a wife is, it's happened over and over again in my tree and for people I work for. So that's my explanation of that. Okay, so why did R.L. Dunlap put IXL above our heads? Well, you've eaten at the ham block. You just didn't know it was the ham block. Daniel Ham had a big thing over his building that said ham. You probably shopped like I do at Ewers in the lion block, named after Ethiel Lion. But those men are gone, and so are their names, whereas the IXL is still here. I think a couple of reasons. One is that despite the fact he was full of fun, Dunlap was a very highly religious man, and I think having his name up there would have been kind of idolatry. And he was foresight enough to see that I'm going to sell this building sooner or later, or somebody is, and we'll have to take that down. But he put IXL up there because he made all his money in cultivators. When you look at the county histories and you look at things about him, this was what he was proud of. I sold over 3,000 cultivators in 1 year. And so he put it up there. It's like Ace Hardware. You know, I'm an IXL guy. And that's why it's still up there. Now that I've said what it is, I'll take it down. But who built the IXL? That's the next mystery. We know, or you'll know a little bit more about how it got built in a second. And we know who put the IXL up there. But who built it? It was Harry Smith. Harry Smith was a carpenter, a builder, and he was the builder and manager of, you can read that two ways, but I have other sources that show he built the roller rink. Well, he built the whole damn thing. And he built City Hall twice, because City Hall burned, thanks to the fire department. And City Hall had to be rebuilt, so he had two contracts for City Hall. He also built the old opera house. He built a number of things in this town, and he gets very little credit for that. He has lots of descendants here, but he gets very little credit for that. He built something called the Armory, which does not exist. It's down basically at the south end of the university library, down near the lumber yard that R.L. Dunlap owned and the coal yard. And that was a wonderful place. People came there for social occasions, political elections, and things like that. But the it also had a roller skating rink. And one unusual thing about that, and I don't think this happened upstairs, was that there was a man who was a vaudeville entertainer. And he had a bear, and that was part of his act. And the bear roller skated. And so Smith let him use the roller rink for his rehearsals. I'm hoping that never happened upstairs. I would think with the bread down here, that would have been bad news, you know? That would have been bad news. So, a few things that we'll just wrap up here. It was smart business to put that up there. He probably liked the pun of IXL because he was supportive of public education and university musical education. That'll be in my book. But he also had a sign. Irving Weber attributes this to his son, but he had a sign on his coal yard office, his lumber yard office, that said, and now it's down at the end of Burlington Street, okay? It's south of, west of the Armory. He had a sign. Now remember, this is an extremely religious man. And the sign was there for everybody to see, and it said, best lumberyard by a dam site, D-A-M-S-I-T-E, okay. And in his advertisements, he often used combinations of letters. O-I-C. O-I-C, you need a cultivator. I keep doing that. You need a cultivator. I've got lots of them. Come see me. So I believe he is the man that did the IXL. It was over his portion of the building. Now, transfer records, which have not been burned, in the recorder's office show that some of the city directories or city histories and county histories say this man was only into agriculture. Well, we know that's not true. And when he first came here, he worked for the government selling pork and other things to the army. That was his first job. He also ran this yard, this lumber yard. He had a flour mill. He did a number of things. But he owned extensive properties on Lynn Street, properties across from the public library and down all the way to where a mailbox is now. In 1881 and 1882, as this project was getting underway, he sold those all off. So he would have money. But it was a conglomerate. He had other people, one of his in-laws, several of his friends that we can identify as being his friends from the Methodist Church. They all got it and had a small slice of it. But he was the top dog. He was the founding father. He loved fun and he loved children. He built a roller rink. I mean, it was a good, clean sport, and he did that for the community. Mr. Ham had one too. My friend Randall tells me that in his experience with other small towns, it was always on the second floor. Because second floor, it was sometimes just storage space, and so they'd convert it to a roller rink. And it's Iowa, so you don't want to put it outside. You want to use it, you know, during the winter months when you can't do anything outside. So Dunlap financed it, Harry built it, and Dunlap named it, and it's his lasting legacy. So as Paul Harvey used to say, now you know the rest of the story. And now it's time for questions, comments, and dessert. Yes, sir.
So if you have a question or comment, please wave me down and I'll bring the mic to you. So we'll start here and then we'll go back there.
I'm just so pleased my voice didn't go on. I'm sorry if the level was not as good if we, you know.
In the first photograph and first drawing you showed of the front of the building, the windows are different. The west portion in the drawing has four windows. In the photograph, it only has three sets of windows.
Will you repeat the question?
Yeah. The gentleman says that in the sketch, as opposed to the photograph of today, the numbers of windows vary. Now, that could be that the sketch just wasn't a very good sketch. I don't know. It's a kind of a perspective sketch. I hadn't noticed that, so thank you. That's the third thing of that slide brought to you by the number three.
There's in the photograph, there's the west has three windows, right. The center has three, and the east has four sets.
But this was the center at that time.
This part.
Yeah, this part. So, because 224 was over here, which was also 226. There were lots of things over there. It was a shoe repair shop, and it wasn't just the restaurant. But thank you for mentioning that. I'll do some work on it and see what I can come up with.
I thought that was City Hall.
No, City Hall was back further. And then they knocked them both down because they needed a parking lot for a bank. This is where we cue the Joni Mitchell, you know, music. Beautiful building. Now, as you all know, next to the senior center, there is a parking deck and some shops. And the old City Hall turret, or reproduction of it, is up on top. And the old clock you can see if you go in a certain entrance over there. So we've retained some of that, but what a wonderful building it was. As opposed to that kind of 1950 or 1960s place we've got. Yes, sir.
Al, if I heard you correctly, you said that at one time this was an odd-numbered address.
Mm-hmm.
It's interesting because in Iowa City, other than what I might consider errors or occasional discrepancies, generally all of the north side of a street and the east side of a north-south street is an even number. And it's simple to remember that by the expression nay, which means born name for a woman, north, east, even, okay. When I give my talk on streets in Iowa City. Can you tell us about the transition, and was this citywide where odd addresses perhaps were on the north side of an east-west street?
Well, Bob might chime in on this, but it's even worse than that, Tom, because the first block, the 100 block, was already there. Now, to be honest, not a lot of people used numbers, you know, in the middle of the 19th century.
You're talking about the 50 block.
Well, where from Pancheros, where Pancheros down to Coldstream now, yeah. Those were always even numbers, and you're right, in the rest of the city. But Bob, were there other places where they changed?
I'm not following.
Well, other streets, it seemed to you had mentioned to me one time in an email But there were other streets that changed from odd to even?
I lived at 1131 Fairchild, which is on the north side of Fairchild Street. It's Fairchild and Reno. Mm-hmm. And it was odd, and the next door house was an even number. We always thought because the house was there long before.
That's true on Church Street, on the east end of Church Street.
Okay. We can blame all that on WF Maine, right?
Between the post office and the fire department through the years, they've tried to impose a uniform numbering system, and it's been very difficult.
When I think...
Make sure that all comments are into the microphone, even though the microphone's not amplified, it gets onto the taping so everyone can hear this great...
I'm sorry, I should be repeating, but... The questions are basically about the odd and even. It is my theory, and it's only a theory, that the first person that built where the bank is now on the corner got it wrong, and then everybody had to get it wrong after them, and then they, maybe this is the terrible thing, you know? It's an interesting question. But they did change it. In some places it went into the middle of the 1890s, but they did change it. And it wasn't the government that changed it, I don't think. It was, you know, individual people.
Al, if I might add one other thing before
please
we leave that.
And make sure
I'd be interested to know your interpretation, and I'm sure this is well known by others, how we get the derivation of block, since it's only a portion of a city block. For example, my family has the Shoe Line block in Western Iowa, the town of, what the heck is it, that came from years ago, Sioux City, called the Shoe Line Block. So it's a section of stores or a storefront as a portion of a city block. How do we come by the designation of block in that instance?
Well, downtown, the block is fairly well defined, and they've kept the same numbers. It is basically a block. You're not crossing a street. You're going around the block. So if you walked from here down to the corner, turn right again, and came back here, you'd be in block 66. Whereas if you went across the street to the Englert, I think it's 65 over there, but it's a different block number. And that, at least in the period I was looking at, they kept that pretty well. Bob?
I think we're dealing somewhat with semantics, because the word block today would be building. And it goes back to Old English times and so forth. So it's just a word that was used in centennial ancient times and not now. We use the word building.
So we'll blame it on England again. Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Can you explain this? I don't understand where the front of this is, the east-west.
This is three different time periods, okay? So on each one of them, the front door would be here. Over here would be 224, which is now non-existent. And over here would be the discerning eye at 218 and the rest of the block. So I'm sorry, I tried to make that something that would be less confusing, but maybe added to the confusion by it.
Although officially, this back part legally is 222, even though in the city directory it's at 220. And I found this out because when I got this business in 2008, I just changed the electrical and gas utilities for 220, because I didn't know there was a 222 back here. So I get a call saying, you're going to get shut off now because you haven't paid your bill. Well, I didn't know that I had a 220 and a 222, so now I know that. Even though in all other records and functionally, this is all from the alley to the front is 220. Technically, we are sitting in 222.
And people often consider 222 to be the upstairs apartments as well. In fact, if you look at the staircase next door, that's what it says. Or 222 and a half is,
yes,
like the official.
So I do want you to notice the purple floor here, and that was part of the rehab to become the cage, the techno non-smoking bar, when it wasn't, it was still legal to smoke in bars. And they were only open Thursday through Saturday. and our manager's office, we still call the DJ booth. That's where our music come from. That's what the Techno Bar's music came from. So we love our purple floors, and you can see we have matching purple tablecloths and seat covers so it will bounce off the floor. So we're happy to have the purple Techno Bar, the cage floors.
Like other people who have come to Province, become prominent.
What years was the Techno Bar?
Right before it was rehabbed to be Don's Hide and Beat Away. So that what you were saying, it was 2004. It was under rehab for a long time. Like over, it was like 2 years. It was a long time, and the cage did not last very long. I think the non-smoking thing did not really work. And only being open 4 days a week, three or four days a week.
I'm sorry if I badmouthed the cage, but it was out of frustration because I could find so little about it. I'm sure it was a great place. I'm all for non-smoking, believe me.
I'm sure many of you will recall in the olden days in Iowa City when the city directories were put together, they were cards were sent out asking you for data and to list who lived there and all that kind of stuff. The cards that were not returned, generally it was dropped out of the directory. And that's what happens often as you use different years of the directories. They drop out or they come in based on the return of a card.
But it might say vacant also in the city directory. It's true of some of the apartments upstairs. That's a good point, Bob.
Watching City Channel 4 on TV, online, on demand, on Facebook, and now on the go on your mobile device.